Hello friends, once again welcome back to Core Chemical Engineering channel. So today in this tutorial I'll discuss about complete understanding of centrifugal pump. In that, what is centrifugal pump, what are the components of centrifugal pump, then working mechanism of centrifugal pump, the function of volute in the centrifugal pump, then after that comes what is priming and cavitation phenomena in centrifugal pump. Then what is the system curve and the head doublet by the pump? How can you decide the operating point of centrifugal pump? All those things in this video I'll discuss. Apart from this, I'll discuss about pump in series operation, pump in parallel operation. So these are the things that I'm gonna discuss in this video. So let's discuss now. So before I'm going to tell you in details of all these things, guys, there is a request from you. So if you haven't subscribed this channel till now, please subscribe this channel, share and like this video. So let's discuss now. So here is centrifugal pump, you can see it here. Okay, so what is centrifugal pump? So centrifugal pump generates high rotational velocity, then convert the resulting kinetic energy of liquid to pressure energy. So what is the function of centrifugal pump? Centrifugal pump is basically generates high rotational velocity by the action of impeller. Okay, so that high rotational velocity will help in increase the pressure and the kinetic energy of the fluid, right? So this is how centrifugal pump works. I'll discuss in details of all these things. You just see as of now the definitions. Now the components of centrifugal pump. Okay, so you can see impeller. So what is impeller? It is a wheel or rotor provided with a series of backward curve vanes. It is mounted on shaft coupled to an external motor. Okay, so impeller is fitted inside casing, so the fluid moving out will be collected inside it and will move in the same direction of rotation impeller to the discharge nozzle. Okay, now let's see casing. Okay, so what is casing? Yeah, it is an airtight chamber which surrounds the impeller, right? So which surrounds the impeller, there is a airtight chamber. That airtight chamber is called as casing. Now what is the special characteristics of that casing? So casing got an increasing area along the flow direction. Such increasing area will help in accumulating newly added water stream and will also help in reducing exit flow velocity, because as your area is getting increased, then your velocity will decrease but pressure will increase. Okay, so reduction in flow velocity will result in increase in static pressure. That's what I told you. So which is required to overcome resistance of the pumping system. So basically this is the heart of the pump. Okay, this is the impeller. Okay, this is the heart of the pump. And the volute, the casing is having a volute, like the casing will have a volute, like that volute will actually have an increasing area, like it will have a cross section like this. Okay, like this. So it will got an increase in area as your fluid is going to discharge through the pump, right? So that was the special characteristics of the casing. Now suction pipe. Pipe connected to an inlet of pump at its upper end and at the lower end into the suction tank. So that's a suction pipe. So as I told you, these are the components: impeller, casing, suction pipe, delivery pipe. Delivery pipe connected at its lower end to the outlet of pump and delivers liquid to the required height, right? Now let's discuss the working mechanism, right? So centrifugal pumps are most preferred pumping devices in any hydraulic work in which mechanical energy of the liquid is increased by centrifugal action. Okay. Now at the heart of the system lies the impeller. It is got series of curved vanes fitted inside shaft blade. The impeller is always immersed in water, immersed in fluid. Like if your fluid is water, then it is immersed in water. When impeller is made to rotate, it makes the fluid surrounding it also rotate. So whenever your impeller is going to rotate, then it also makes the fluid surrounding it rotate. Okay, so that imparts centrifugal force to the fluid, right? And the fluid moves radially out. Since the rotational mechanical energy is transferred to the fluid at the discharge side of the impeller, both pressure and kinetic energy of the fluid will rise. Okay, so that is how we give the pressure and kinetic energy into the fluid by the action of impeller, right? So at suction side, water is getting displaced, so negative pressure will induce at the end. So because of the rotational, like impeller rotation, negative pressure will create at the eye of the impeller, and that such low pressure helps in sucking fresh fluid stream into the suction again, and the process continues. Because see, if we are not able to create the low pressure at the suction of the eye, then you can't suck the water from the reservoir, because any fluid will flows from high pressure to low pressure, right? And if you are not able to create the low pressure at the suction of the eye, then you can't suck the water, like you can't take the water from the high pressure to low pressure region. So that is the function of impeller, and that impeller basically by the rotation of the impeller, it creates the low pressure at the eye of the impeller, right? So this is the whole working mechanism for centrifugal pump. In simple words, like I have written it here now, and that is the reason, like what I have told you, that is the reason why priming is important for centrifugal pump. Because if no fluid is present initially, the negative pressure developed by the rotating air and the eye of the impeller will negligibly small to suck fresh stream of fluid. Because if air is present at the eye of the impeller, so whenever impeller will like rotate, it won't be able to create the low pressure at the eye of the impeller. So you can't suck the water properly. So that was that's what I told you about the working mechanism of pump. So I hope you understood the working mechanism of centrifugal pump. Now we'll discuss about difference between system head curve and head developed by pump. Okay, these two things are very important, and you must able to understand the fine line difference between the system, like pump system curve, okay, and the head developed by the pump. So first, system head curve. So it is the total resistance pump must overcome, okay? So it is basically the resistance to the pump is your system head curve, right? So it consists of following components. So pump has to like overcome all these resistances, like static head, friction head, pressure head, weld drawn, okay? So these are the resistance that pump must overcome, and that pressure actually basically that resistance is represented in terms of feet, okay, in terms of height. That is called your system head curve. So you can see it here, static head. So what is static head? It represents the net change in height in feet that the pump must overcome. It applies only in open system, because in closed system static head would be zero. Now friction head, so this is also called pressure drop. When fluid flows through any system component, friction results, okay, this causes the loss in pressure, and the components causing friction include piping, boiler, chiller, heat exchanger, fitting, walls, etc. So the pump must overcome this friction also. So this is also resistance, this is also resistance for a pump. Now, pressure head. When a liquid is pumped from a vessel at one pressure to a vessel at another pressure, head exists. Common application includes condensate pumps and boiler feed pump. Suppose there is a closed system, like you have to suck the water. Suppose your vessel, industry will be seeing that in the condensate pumps, a vessel would be there, in that already 20 to 30 kg pressure would be maintained, and then that would be the suction pressure of a pump. And if you are going to, by the action of the your centrifugal pump, it gives a discharge pressure around 70 kg. So you will already have there is a difference between the pressure where you are going to deliver the fluid. It won't be always atmospheric pressure. So that pressure actually where you are going to give the discharge pressure is basically your pressure head. So that is also a resistance to the pumping system. Now well drawn. So what is well drawn? Decrease in water level in the well in responding to pump. Suppose there is a small reservoir, if you have a drum from drum or any vessel you are pumping. So as you are pumping, as you started pumping, and your level in the drum also got decreasing, so that case is called well drawn. So that also counts in the resistance causing to the pump. So how to decide operating point for centrifugal pump? So before that, let's see here. Okay, total head, this was the graph that I have represented for system head curve for a pump. Okay, so this is the total head in feet, discharge flow rate in, this is this x-axis is your discharge flow rate Q in gallon per minute. So this height, a brown color, I have marked as static head, this graph is your well drawn, and the red one is your friction loss. As you increase the, because static head would be constant, like there would be some height from a pump from where you have to give take the suction and give the discharge. That height level is basically your what do you call as your static, you know, static head. Now your well drawn, because your level is getting decreased as your pump is giving flow rate. So with the flow rate, your head will total head will, system head will increase. Now if your friction, because as flow rate will increase, because your velocity will increase, so your friction will also increase, right? So this will also increase, it will follow as your flow rate will increase. This graph red follow this path. Now operating head, from where you are going to give the discharge pressure. So as your flow rate increases, your this will also follow this path. So total overall, like if you club all these resistance in a single like a diagram, so equivalent of that, you'll get this net system head curve represented as total head, flow rate. So you'll get the graph like this. So this is the net system head curve. So that accounts all these components. Okay, all these components means friction head, pressure head, well drawn, and static head. Okay, all this counts for system head curve. Now head developed by the pump. Before I am going to tell you regarding how to decide operating point for centrifugal pump, I am going to tell net head developed by the pump. So you might have read in the Michael Smith book or somewhere that the pump pressure rise equation, you will be knowing that H equal to U2 by G into U2 minus Q upon AP 10 beta. So this is the relation for a centrifugal pump where it gives the head developed by the pump. U2 is your blade velocity at outlet. Suppose this is your what do you call centrifugal pump impeller, and the you know the rotation will be in this direction, and beta will be your blade angle. Okay, and V2 is your fluid velocity, right, at the outlet, and VR2 is your radial velocity, and V theta 2 is your angular velocity. So this is your total head developed by the pump. Q is your flow rate, AP is your peripheral area, 10 beta, you have to take 10 of that beta value. So you can read the this derivation of this equation in the Michael Smith book also. So AP is peripheral area of impeller, 2 pi R2 into V2, R2 is radius, okay, radius of impeller, and V2 is the width of the impeller. Q is equal to 2 pi R2 V2 into VR2, VR2 is your radial velocity of fluid, okay, flow time, flow area times radial velocity is your flow rate, okay, and VR2 is radial velocity of the fluid, you can see, V2 is fluid velocity at the outlet. So this is how you can calculate the head developed by the pump, okay. So this one is because your U2, like blade velocity would be constant, if your RPM is constant, then blade velocity would be constant, flow rate, like you can either you can vary flow rate or beta. So beta you can vary, like it should be 90 degree, less than 90 degree for the backward curvings, and this value beta less than 90 degree is only applicable for backward, like is applicable for backward curve blades, and the pump would be stable in the case of backward curve blades only, right? So you can see it in accordance with the pressure rise equation, theoretical head and the flow rate relation should be straight line. So you can see if you are going to draw the graph for head versus flow rate, the slope is negative. If your beta is less than 90 degree, okay, whole term will be, this term will be positive. So net slope would be your negative, right? And it should be a straight line, because y is equal to minus mx plus c kind of, right? Because all are constant. If your beta is constant, AP will be constant, U2 will be constant. So all are terms. So head relation would be with the flow rate. So h equal to minus mx plus c kind of thing. So your slope would be negative, right? So you will get, ideally you should get the graph like this. This is the theoretical head, but okay, so in accordance with the pressure rise equation, the theoretical head and the flow rate relation should be straight line as per blade angle beta, right? For backward curve blade, beta value is less than 90 degree, therefore slope will be get negative, right? But you will be seeing that the actual, like you know, but the actual head developed at the given flow rate is considerably less, because you will see that the actual head developed by the pump would be less than the theoretical head, because less, and drops to zero as the flow rate increases to certain value. So whenever this value drops to zero, that point is basically your, this is known as zero head flow rate. So at this flow rate, it is the maximum flow the pump can deliver under any conditions. Okay, your head would be zero and your flow rate would be maximum. So this is the maximum flow any pump can deliver. Okay, at this point, right? So reason for the difference between actual and theoretical head is that the difference between theoretical and actual performance results primarily from circulatory flow, right? Friction is high at its maximum flow, shock losses are minimum at the rated operating conditions of the pump and becomes greater as the flow rate is increased or decreased from the rated value, right? So that is the reason, the difference between the actual and the theoretical head. Now, long awaited question, let's discuss now operating point for the centrifugal pump. Now let's draw both the graphs at the single plot, system head curve and the head doubled by the pump. So head versus flow rate, this is the system head curve. So this is the resistance that pump must overcome in order to give the flow, right? And this is the head doubled by the pump. So the point where both the curves intersect is the basically your operating point for the centrifugal pump. So this is the operating point for the centrifugal pump, right? Now we'll discuss about power consumption in centrifugal pump. So power curve represents the load to the pump imposes on the driver at a given point on the power pump curve. So fluid power PF rises with the flow rate to maximum value at or near the rated capacity, then falls slightly. Okay, so you can see it here. Ideally power curve kya hota hai, it should be your straight line, but you will see that the fluid power PF rises with the flow rate to a maximum value at or near the rated capacity, then falls slightly. The total or the actual power required PB rises through the most of the range of the flow rate. Okay, so as your flow rate increases, then the PB is your power required for the pump to run. So it will increase as your flow rate will increase, your PB will increase, but power delivered to the flow will increase to a certain time, then after that, okay, it will decrease when flow is reached at the rated capacity. After that, your power developed by the fluid will be decreased, right? So the difference between them represents power lost in the pump. So what we give the power in the motor, we give supply electrical power, okay, in the motor in the pump, and that total power can't be converted into the fluid power. Okay, so that loss would be basically, it results from the fluid friction and shock losses, both of which are conversion of mechanical energy to heat, and by leakage, disc friction, bearing losses, all those things will come into those losses. Okay, so you can't convert the total what motor have taken the power, and you can't deliver the sole power into the the fluid power. So that was the graph for power. Now let's discuss for efficiency. So power efficiency is basically fluid power divided by total power consumed. Okay, so here this is the 100% efficiency. This is eta versus efficiency versus flow rate. So it will increase to certain value. After rated value, it will decrease, right? Efficiency will decrease. So now the efficiency rises rapidly with the flow rate at a low rate reaches maximum at or near rated capacity, then falls as the flow rate approaches the zero head value, right? Now let's discuss about affinity laws for pump. So what is the importance of affinity laws of pump? You will get to know here. Okay, so when a complete set of performance curves is not available, the characteristics of particular pump can be predicted from a similar pump and theoretical equations for an ideal pump, right? So whenever you know that characteristics of a particular pump is not available, then we can define the characteristics of that particular pump, okay, from the similar pump and the theoretical equations involved in the design of ideal pump. So the relationship of impeller size and speed to the capacity, head and power are called affinity laws. So the relationship of impeller size and speed to the capacity, head and power, okay, is your affinity laws basically. So characteristics is the constant diameter, constant RPM, okay. So capacity relation, when your density is diameter is constant, then your Q will vary as proportional to N, okay. RPM, rotation of the impeller. Now head will be when your diameter of the pump is constant, okay, if you have taken another pump, in that case the diameter is constant for the both pump. In that case, head would be proportional to delta H is proportional to N square, and power is proportional to N cube, Okay, RPM raised to the power n3. Now, for the case of one, RPM is same for the both the pump. In that case, Q is proportional to diameter, head is proportional to D square, and power is proportional to DQ. So this is the relation for the affinity loss for the pump. So you must remember this. This is very important with respect to the gate exam also. Now let's discuss about pumps in series and parallel operation. So first, series operation head-to-head. Okay, in this case. So when centrifugal pumps are connected in series, if the discharge of one pump is connected to the suction side of a second pump, each pump is putting energy into the pumping fluid, so the resultant head is the sum of individual head. So this delta H1 is the head developed by this pump, and delta H2 is the head developed by another pump. So total head developed is basically your delta H1 plus delta H2. Ideally, it should be two times, okay? Like in the total head developed is basically delta H1 plus delta H2. For pumps, you know, you are going to connect in series, in that case the pump must be similar, because otherwise if you are not able to provide the proper suction to the second pump, in that case also cavitation will occur, so lot of problem will be there. So if you plan to put the two pumps in the series, in that case those pumps must be similar, I guess. So you can see the curve here. This is the head developed by single pump, this is the system curve, right? So when you are going to club the two pumps, in that case your total head would be the twice. If the pumps are similar, then your total head developed by the pump in the series of two pumps would be approximately twice the single pumps. So here you can see, in that case this curve will come like this. So 0.3 would be the operating case for the second case, when two pumps are in series, and when the single pump is operating, then one would be the your operating point, right? So centrifugal pumps are operated in parallel when two or more pumps are connected to a common discharge line and share the same suction line. You can see it here, sharing the same suction line, and they are connected to the common discharge. This kind of philosophy is basically used in the all industry, because in every industry they can't really reliable on only one pump. In case that pump got tripped or any faults come on that pump, then whole system will get disturbed. So in order to avoid that whole system not to get disturbed, for that case they plan always there would be a spare pump. Okay, in any industry, if the pumps are critical, then two pumps would be there. There is a philosophy of having the two pumps, and both the pumps will be connected in the parallel. So you can operate both the pumps together if you need higher flow rate, and if you want to keep one pump as a spare for the backup, another pump is running. Okay, then people install in industry in this kind of arrangement only, right? For two identical pumps in parallel, and head is kept constant, because head would be constant, and the flow rate approximately doubles as indicated with the 0.2 compared to a single point. So two pumps in parallel will deliver less than twice the flow rate of a single pump in the system because of increased friction in the piping. So you can see it, the graph here. This is the for the single pump, this is the system curve, this is for single pump, and this is the for two pumps in parallel. So this flow rate, you can see it is approximately twice the flow rate developed by the single pump, right? So that was all about pumps in series and parallel operation. Now we'll discuss about cavitation. So about this topic, I had already made one separate video, and I'll give the link of that video in the description box. You guys can go click on that video and watch in details. But in short and short way, I'll tell you it here. Okay, so when cavitation will occur basically. Okay, so I'll tell you here. So you see it here. Here is your suction, and you have to give the discharge pressure to another pressure level, and there exists an eye of impeller. So whenever you are going to operate you are going to start the pump, a negative pressure will create at the eye of the impeller so that it can suck the water from the reservoir, right? So imagine just the case when the negative pressure that you are going to develop at the eye of the impeller, goes below the vapor pressure of a fluid, in that case bubble formation will start, and that bubbles will impinge on the impeller with the high pressure, so it will damage the impeller, also erode the impeller, right? So that gives the knocking kind of sound in the pump, that noisy sound in the pump. Okay, so that phenomenon is basically called cavitation. So in field if you want to know whether pump is cavitating or like giving cavitation sound or not. Okay, so for that you can see the vibration probes would be there, that will give the vibration in the pump, or like otherwise it gives undesirable sounds. So you'll get to know, like if you are a normal, like if you are observing the pumps from day-to-day life, you'll get to know whether pump is cavitating or not. So that was the simple reason. You can see it here. This one is your suction pressure, PS. This is the eye of the impeller. This is the discharge pressure. This is your vapor pressure. This fine line, okay, blue color line is your vapor pressure of the fluid. So for the pump to operate, pressure at the eye of the impeller must less than the suction pressure, okay, so that water will flow from here to here. And the discharge pressure must give, because we are using pumps, so the discharge pressure must be than the suction pressure. So it gives the discharge pressure here. So if the pressure at the eye of the impeller goes below the, like this line, okay, goes below the vapor pressure of the line, then cavitation will occur. So that is the simple, short and sweet way, I tried to tell you guys for better understanding. So you can see the definition here also. When suction pressure at the eye of the impeller falls below the vapor pressure of the fluid, then cavitation occurs. So guys, that's all for this video. So I have tried well to explain you guys in the simple way what is centrifugal pump, how it operates, what is the working mechanism, and what are the components involved in that, what is cavitation, what is priming, what is the difference between system head curve and the system head curve and the head developed by the pump, what is the operating point for the pump, series and parallel operation for the pumps. I have told all these things in this video. So that's all for today. So guys, thank you so much. So if you guys have liked this video, please don't forget to subscribe this channel, and let me know into the comment box if you want to know anything else apart from this video, or if you want to give any feedback for improvement, or any topic if you want to know, you guys just comment in the comment box. So thank you so much.